seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When Apollo 11 broke free from the launch pad, the world seemed to be on the threshold of a new age of space exploration. Amongst those watching in the control room 30 years ago was Dr. Wernher von Braun, the father of the Saturn rocket that was to carry the astronauts to the moon.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Thrust is good. Everything's still looking good.
He'd promised the journey would mark a new step in man's evolution. From the moon, man would go on to explore new worlds, and all mankind would benefit. Von Braun was fated as America's new Columbus.
Wernher von Braun had a dream when he was a young boy and lived to make that dream come true.
He was convinced that spaceflight is one step of evolution for mankind, and that fate somehow selected him to be the driver for it.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
But this new dawn for man in space brought for a few only dark memories of their work on von Braun's first space rocket as slave laborers.
Von Braun had brains. He was a great man. But he didn't care about anybody, about anything. He wanted his rocket, whatever the cost.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down.
He believed that humanity belonged in space, and he was willing to pay a price for it. Something Faustian about that, isn't there?
I'm at the foot of the ladder.
For Wernher von Braun, it had been a lifelong crusade. But to cross the threshold into space, no price appeared to be too much to pay. His team's rocket to the moon was born of the ballistic missile, and the new step in man's evolution he'd promised was marked by a personal journey from the Nazis to NASA.
With me, it started with the moon. I liked the look of the moon, the stars, and when I had my Lutheran confirmation at the age of 13, my parents gave me a telescope, and that was like giving a boy a motorbicycle, I guess. My interest in astronomy has never faded away.
It was an interest born in the Berlin of the 1920s. Wernher von Braun was from the privileged world of Germany's aristocracy, the son of Baron Magnus von Braun. His family had owned land in the East German state of Prussia for centuries. But most of Werner's childhood was spent at his father's residence in Berlin.
The family was conservative and about as Prussian as you can get.
Achtung! Die neue Reichsregierung.
Werner's father, apart from being a landowner, was also a politician.
Von Braun.
A true monarchist. I remember he once said to me, you know, this thing with democracy, that's a fashion, it'll pass.
Wernher was the second of the Baron's three sons. His father's values were at the heart of their upbringing, with an emphasis on order and personal discipline.
And they greeted their father, they would greet him with a kiss on the hand, bow very deep. It's the Prussian thing. Extreme self-control. You do not show if you hurt. You do not show your pain.
The von Braun house was a place of some cultivation, thanks largely to Werner's mother. In it, he acquired a lifelong passion for music. By the time he was a schoolboy, he'd developed a more surprising passion for rockets.
Very sophisticated German upper-class environment. It's a strange place to find a person like Wernher von Braun interested in what at that time was a very plebeian subject, namely rockets.
It was an interest shared with thousands of his countrymen. There was a belief that a large enough rocket could power anything. During the First World War, it was used as a weapon. Now, in the utopian spirit of the times, it was hoped the rocket would open the door to the peaceful exploration of space. The work of these amateur rocketeers inspired von Braun and his brother to carry out their own experiments.
They took firework rockets to build a little rocket-driven sled. It crashed into the basement window of a grocery shop, and my father at that time said, well, that's the end of space travel for me. And Werner kept going.
The fascination with rockets blossomed into an interest in astronomy when his parents gave him the telescope.
That really kicked me off. And it was actually in one of these amateur astronomer magazines, 1925, that I stumbled across a book written by Professor Hermann Oberth, which was entitled The Rocket to Planetary Species. And I sent for that book, and of course I couldn't understand a word because it was full of mathematical formula.
The book described how a liquid-fueled rocket might be used for interplanetary flight. Oberth's ideas were to reach a wider audience when in 1929 he was asked to be the technical advisor on Fritz Lang's film The Woman in the Moon. The film showed the preparation of a liquid-fueled space rocket. Unlike conventional engines, Oberth's liquid-fueled rocket didn't need air and so could fly in space. The film's rocket was prepared for launch with the first ever countdown.
It depicted a voyage to the moon. It showed that, first of all, how you might launch a rocket. You see a multi-stage rocket take off, the stages fall off, and you get the depiction of weightlessness. So it foresaw to a certain degree, you know, the reality of what happened 50, 60 years later.
It was a vision of space flight that would set the course of von Braun's life. He later wrote of Hermann Oberth as his guiding light.
You know, when you are 13 years old, the world looks awfully simple and beautiful. Although I didn't understand all of it, I got the message loud and clear that people can fly one fine day with rockets, not only to the moon, but also to the planets. And I decided that right then and there, this was for me.
At school, von Braun began writing his own papers on space travel. There is no doubt, he wrote in one, that man will one day walk on the moon. He was a gifted student. School friends also recognized his determination to lead.
War er fest überzeugt, das schaffe ich, das werde ich schaffen. Und da kam eben immer wieder das Gespräch, würdest du mir dann zur Verfügung stehen? Jawohl, ich würde dir zur Verfügung stehen, das möchte ich. Dann fliegen wir zusammen zum Mond, denn das war ja das Ziel.
After leaving school, von Braun joined a group of amateur rocket enthusiasts and began building and testing his own liquid-fueled engines. When publicizing the group's work, he told those prepared to listen that spaceflight would happen in their lifetimes.
Many people thought we were crazy and we were wasting our time, but von Braun liked to say, a person is just a crackpot until he hits the jackpot.
The group was always short of money. There was one obvious source, the German army, and in the summer of 1932, it arranged a demonstration for the army of its latest rocket. Von Braun was filmed preparing it for launch. The army wasn't impressed with the rocket, but it promised the group money if it agreed to work in complete secrecy. The offer was rejected by all the members but one, Werner von Braun.
He was a very practical man, you might say an opportunist in that sense. He cast his lot, to the despair of some of his associates, with the German army ordnance.
The relationship between military money and space was to dominate von Braun's life. At the age of 20, he began work at the Army's secret testing ground outside Berlin. The Army would sponsor his doctorate at Berlin University. Von Braun would build weapons for the Army. It was a compromise he was happy to make.
Er wollte die Rakete und glaubte nun, dann die Möglichkeit zu besitzen, über diese Heeresaufträge zu einer raumfähigen Flüssigkeitsrakete zu kommen.
He began work with only 3 colleagues and half a test stand. But within 3 years, his small team had outstripped the existing rocket technology. Von Braun was involved in more than just the design. He built and tested the rockets himself.
He took part in practical work, yeah, and as a matter of fact, he educated us to that. He said, "You people, get your hands dirty." Von Braun said, "I'm not the top of all, I'm one of you people." Yeah? And that was very attractive, of course, to his co-workers.
He had an incredible physical presence, a great deal of charisma, and he had a very, very strong managerial concept and the ability to create really an enormous degree of loyalty amongst his subalterns.
Three months after von Braun began his work with the army, a new chancellor took over the leadership of Germany, Adolf Hitler. Von Braun had plans for a large rocket with a range of 300 kilometers. The Nazis' zeal for rearmament would give him the opportunity to build it. Von Braun would need a larger team and new facilities. He began searching for an isolated site on the Baltic Sea, suitable for a secret missile program.
Of all the persons, it was his mother who said, "I know a place up in the north on a little island where your father went duck hunting some years ago in the Baltic Sea."
The new Peenemünde rocket facility was built quickly and in secret. Von Braun became its technical director. He was still only 25. 2,000 engineers and scientists would eventually work on the new rocket, the A-4. There was no doubt about its future use. It was to carry a 1-ton warhead. The A-4 was expected to travel close to 300 kilometers. So far, a rocket hadn't managed more than a few thousand meters. Building it would cost millions of marks. And for that, the team needed the support of the Führer himself. On the eve of war, Hitler visited the army's testing ground to be briefed by von Braun and his military superior, Colonel Walter Dornberger. Their demonstration began with a rocket engine test at a bunker on the site.
Da war doch festzustellen, dass Hitler momentan beeindruckt war. Und erstens war es ein ungeheurer Lärm, der plötzlich auftrat, und diese schweren Bäume in der Umgebung, die sind unter dem Eindruck der abgeleiteten Auspuffgase so richtig meterweit nach allen Seiten umgebogen worden.
Hitler was impressed by the test, but skeptical about the timetable for the development of the rocket. Von Braun barely managed to raise a smile for the official photograph. His briefing had not gone well.
Hitler sagte noch, und es war mir damals interessant, "Ich bin nicht interessiert an Entwicklungen, die über lange Jahre gehen. Wie lange schätzen Sie," sagte jetzt wieder zu Dornberger von Braun, "wie Ihre Entwicklung?" "Ja, 5 bis 10 Jahre. Das ist viel zu lang."
Within 6 months, Germany was at war with Britain and her allies. Work on the missile accelerated in spite of Hitler's skepticism. And war didn't weaken von Braun's commitment to his work.
He was, end of his 20s, and suddenly you're in a position where you get unlimited funds to develop what you're interested in. Very tempting.
The future of the rocket was uppermost in von Braun's mind when he'd joined the Nazi Party in 1937. Now he was invited to join the SS by its leader, Heinrich Himmler.
He told us, "I just got a letter from Himmler that he offered me a degree in the SS. Yeah? And he said, should I do it or should I not do it? What is your opinion, yeah? Would it be good for us or would it be bad for us?"
It was good for the rocket program, so von Braun joined. this is the only known photograph of SS Major Werner von Braun in his black uniform, caught by the camera standing behind Himmler himself. 5 years after beginning the work, von Braun's rocket was at last ready for testing. On October the 3rd, 1942, the A-4 was prepared for launch. Von Braun and his military superior, Colonel Walter Dornberger, were filmed carrying out the last-minute checks. On its side, the team had painted the image of Fritz Lang's Woman in the Moon. At shortly before 4 o'clock, Dornberger gave the order to launch the rocket. The Nazis could celebrate the creation of a new rocket-based weapon. But for von Braun and his team, this was the first step on the road to space travel.
We had a little party that evening, a little celebration. Now remember that Dornberger made a pretty emotional speech. He says, "Do you realize that today the spaceship was born?"
Man hatte nicht den Eindruck, dass den Herren bewusst war, eine tödliche Waffe zu entwickeln. Ich glaube, da war Werner von Braun der entscheidende Mann dazu. Der hatte von vornherein irgendwie das Fluidum verbreitet. Das ist jetzt mal ein notwendiger Umweg. Die eigentliche Entwicklung, die geht später weiter nach dem Krieg.
The successful October the 3rd launch seemed like a lucky one-off. Of the next 11, only a couple were even partially successful. But it was now essential to secure Hitler's support for the rocket.
Von Braun and Dornberger, of course, wanted to keep Peenemünde going. They did not want Hitler to say, "Well, I don't believe in this whole crap here. Just cancel your fancy rockets." So they showed Hitler a picture which was positive in the sense that Peenemünde should stay alive.
In the private film theater at Hitler's headquarters, von Braun gave one of the most important briefings of his life. It included a film of the successful launch. The film ended with a caption, carefully placed to remind the Führer of his earlier skepticism. It said simply, "We made it after all."
Hitler more or less changed his mind because of the presentation of the movie we had produced. He was quite jovial, yeah, and he praised von Braun.
At the end of the film, he abruptly said, we have something pretty formidable here, and ordered immediately the highest priority to put the thing into quantity production.
The A4 would have a new name that would reflect Hitler's hopes. It became the V2, the second vengeance weapon, the weapon he hoped would win the war for Germany. The missile was to be built in a secret underground factory in the Harz Mountains of Germany. Concentration camp labor would be used to assemble it. But first, the existing tunnel space needed to be increased. For 5 months, 8,000 prisoners worked in the tunnels of the Mittelwerk without seeing the light of day. They were brutally driven by the SS guards who supervised the work.
Here, in this hell, I thought that my life had passed and that the execution had taken place and that I was in hell. No.
Thousands met their deaths in the Mittelwerk. Most were worked to death. Some were executed by the SS.
When I arrived, the gallows were just for one man. And after a while, they built a bigger one for six people. And they used this one sometimes for 12, because they put two men at the same hook. So it means that it was a sort of a industrial system.
Production of the V2 finally began in the spring of 1944. Von Braun visited the tunnels on many occasions. Recently discovered documents prove he was present at meetings when slave labor was discussed. At one such meeting, it was agreed that to replace those who'd already died in the tunnels, a further 2,000 skilled Frenchmen would be enslaved. Von Braun also visited the nearby Buchenwald concentration camp to choose skilled prisoners for work on the V2. After the war, he admitted he'd visited the tunnels, but said he'd played no part in the use of slave labor.
We knew, I knew, and most of the people knew the name von Braun. He was, in my opinion, a son of a bitch. Of course, he had brains. He was a great man. He had something in his head, but he didn't care about what could happen to the poor guys who were there. He saw just the final result.
The first V-2s were fired at London on the evening of September the 8th, 1944. A new age of warfare had begun. The V-2 would eventually claim 5,000 lives, almost all civilians. Von Braun had pushed and pushed for the development of the rocket, but now seemed surprised by news of its firing.
He said that should never have happened. We built our rocket to hit the moon, but not to hit other people.
For some time, von Braun had recognized that Germany would lose the war. He'd already been overheard making plans for a world without the Nazis.
They had a party and they were talking, of course, a little bit much alcohol. Yeah. Very freely, yeah, about this no future here in Germany. Yeah, we have to go to space and we have to find somebody who can afford that. Yeah. Maybe we were a little bit careless.
The conversation was overheard by an SS spy, and von Braun spent 2 uncomfortable weeks in jail. But the architect of the wonder weapon was soon back in favour. Hitler awarded him Germany's highest civilian decoration in recognition of his services to the Reich. It didn't change von Braun's private skepticism about the course of the war.
Dann ging mit mir am Ufer der Ostsee dann auf und ab. Sagte, wir können uns ja da offen drüber unterhalten. Ich habe meine Kisten schon gepackt, die ganzen Unterlagen, den Stab, den ich brauche, und ich biete mich den Amerikanern an. Machte der vollkommen kühl, dann sagte, und dann mache ich meine Weltraumrakete.
Loyalty to his team and the rocket now came before duty to country. Von Braun knew Peenemunde's expertise would be sought after. In the winter of 1944, he approached trusted members of his team to see if they'd be prepared to work for the enemy.
It was clear to us that Germany will never be able to win that war. And so von Braun said, well, maybe we can continue in America.
Nobody else could afford such a big project, well, big idea in going into space but America. Yeah.
With Soviet troops only miles away, the decision was taken to evacuate Peenemunde. The V-2 had impressed the Soviet Union as much as the United States, but there was no talk in the team of surrendering to the Red Army.
Everybody was keen to have them. You know, the Russians had a search list of people they wanted to get, and von Braun was on near the top of that list. But von Braun was a convinced anti-communist.
Von Braun and his team waited for the Americans in the villages of the Bavarian Alps. On the day after Hitler's death was officially announced, von Braun's younger brother was sent to make contact with the enemy. The American army treated von Braun like a celebrity. He was still recovering from a bad car accident, but he was in excellent spirits, boasting to an army journalist that, given 2 more years, the V-2 could have won the war for Germany. The army interrogators were told only as much as would whet their appetites, but they were impressed. Von Braun and key team members were offered contracts with the U.S. Army.
We got 125 plus of the most brilliant rocket scientists in the world. We got components to to make about more than 70 V-2s that we could fly in this country, and we got the all the documentation. Incredible prize.
American troops had, a month before, liberated the Mittelwerk. They'd found only living skeletons. 20,000 prisoners had died making weapons at the factory. Half the deaths were directly related to the production of the V-2. But the American army wasn't interested in war crimes committed at the Mittelwerk. To avoid difficult questions being asked about the records of its new employees, the army began searching German archives for incriminating material. Embarrassing documents were removed. Security reports compiled by American investigators were rewritten.
Orders would come back from Washington, reconsider this security report that says he is a potential security threat. Inconvenient facts like von Braun's SS membership were sort of swept under the rug.
It does happen here. In the vast wastes of the New Mexico desert, the United States Army tests the 14-ton German V-2 rocket. And as far away as El Paso, Texas, residents prepare for flight day.
Within months of the war ending, von Braun and his team were back in business, this time in the service of the United States Army.
Captured in Germany, the terrifying weapon the Nazis banked on to win the war for them is now ready to spearhead our own intensive experiments.
The Americans brought not just the team, but 70 of its rockets to the New Mexico desert. But now the war was over, no one knew what to do with them.
In a way, we were prisoners. We could not freely move around. So the first few years in Fort Bliss, we were really not all that busy, because the intent was to keep us away from the Russians.
The team grumbled that it was on ice in the desert, but food was plentiful and they were paid for their work. If it wasn't the good life, it was a lot better than being in Berlin.
Von Braun, of course, was thinking again big, and he had already some plans, and we were working on some plans to design and build something. But of course the army said, no, that's not what we want.
Teaching the American army about the V-2 wasn't the cutting edge of rocket research, but it left von Braun plenty of time to dream about space flight.
This clear air here, you can see stars like there. You don't see them anywhere else. And we would be out here between various steps and getting a missile ready. Quite often, Werner would come out to see what was going on. And we would talk about going to the stars, going to the moon and to Mars.
It was the threat of war that again gave von Braun his opportunity.
The threat of the Soviet Union's massive military machine.
By 1950, a fear of communist domination gripped the United States. The tentacles of the Soviet Union seemed to be stretching out across the globe. The Cold War enemy had to be stopped, and a new generation of rockets would be needed. Rockets capable of carrying a nuclear warhead.
Whose supreme goal is world domination.
The Army rescued its missile team from the desert and moved it to the southern state of Alabama. Huntsville was a poor cotton town with a population of less than 20,000 when the team arrived. Within a generation, it would become Rocket City. The Army's missile agency took over an old arsenal on the outskirts of the town. Von Braun had at last got his hands on a large rocket project. Thousands of Americans would work on the Redstone missile under the guidance of the Germans. But von Braun was now determined to break down barriers.
The move to Huntsville gave him the opportunity that he wanted to Americanize his team from the very outset, to integrate himself as well as his team into the community. And he was the leader and set the example in that regard.
The leather coat had gone. Von Braun's accent remained, but there was an impressive command of idiomatic English. And he was now a family man. 3 years before arriving in Huntsville, he'd married his 18-year-old cousin, Maria. His second daughter was born in Huntsville. A son would follow.
He did have home life, but it was relatively, you know, restricted. He was, by any measure, a workaholic. And he'd look at the wash and said, Fred, we won't have time to go home, so we better call the girls. So we'd call our wives, they'd come down, but give us a new a change of shirt, and we'd go out to the arsenal.
Von Braun's efforts to Americanize himself and the team were rewarded shortly after the move, when they were sworn in as citizens of the United States. The past was something that could now be put behind him. When asked, he took the line he would take to the end.
Dr. von Braun, you were obliged to work under Adolf Hitler. How is it for a scientist to work under a democracy as compared to that dictatorship?
The longer this thing dragged on, the more evident it became to many people that Hitler's cause just wasn't worthy. But by then, you found yourself tied up in that machine, having to work for something that you didn't believe in yourself. It was pretty rough.
About the future of rocketry.
I'm sure happy that all this is over, and I'm proud to be an American citizen now.
Well, I can understand.
As the Army Missile Agency's new technical director, von Braun now had the credentials he needed to push for a space program. He'd already demonstrated his talent as a rocket salesman. From his home in Huntsville, he set about selling space. It meant a direct appeal to the American taxpayer.
He said, unless we can develop in those people an understanding and a liking and an eagerness for spaceflight, we will never make progress.
The inhabitants are all in line and they work perfectly.
The task von Braun had set himself was a formidable one, to make the fiction of spaceflight a reality.
Flash, what are those awful creatures?
I never saw anything like them. They must be from another planet.
Americans had a wonderful time reading science fiction stories. Buck Rogers kind of science fiction with moon maidens and strange alien creatures. The public was quite enthralled with that. But as a result of reading these stories, most people believed that space travel was just a fantasy.
Von Braun set about his task with the zeal of a missionary. His first success was in print, with a series of articles in the popular weekly Collier's Magazine. In its pages, he painted a remarkably accurate vision of the future in space. The journey would begin with a massive four-stage rocket, which would launch a satellite and then a space station. Man would travel on to the Moon and Mars. But it wasn't a utopian vision of peaceful coexistence in space. The space station could be used to guide atomic warheads to Earth. To the readers of Collier's, it was a revelation. Everything appeared to be calculated down to the last ton of fuel. But not everyone was impressed by von Braun's maths.
I talked to him and I said, you don't really believe the calculations that were used for your satellite. And he said, doesn't matter. This is just advertising. And he said, you know, you amaze me. You're an American and you don't realize that advertising is the most important thing in this country. He says, you will never sell the space program with your down-to-earth view, but I will sell it and you'll get the benefit of it.
We present the first of our science factual programs, Man in Space.
Now here's a model, my design for a four-stage orbital rocket ship. Compared to the unmanned instrument rocket, it is quite large.
It was with the help of Walt Disney that von Braun was to do his most effective advertising.
The payload in the top section will consist of 10 crew members plus equipment.
Disney commissioned a television series built around von Braun and his ideas.
Present high altitude flying.
Today, von Braun appears rather stiff in front of the camera. But in the 50s, his accent and deliberate delivery represented the voice of scientific progress.
It has been designed for use at extremely high altitudes and is a forerunner of the suits we will wear when we make that trip to the moon.
He spoke convincingly by opening himself up and letting people see a little bit of what made him tick.
Notice the wings.
Lots of people have tried to emulate it. You had to have the charisma which he had, kind of a magnetism, which he exuded. He had blue eyes and he looked at you, and the eyes just gripped you, endearing himself very much, just like a salesman does. He was able instinctively to get under your skin.
The Disney programs were an enormous success, with nearly 50 million viewers for each episode. By the end of the decade, most Americans believed space travel would be possible. Von Braun was the man who'd done most to convince them.
If we were to start today on an organized and well-supported space program, I believe a practical passenger rocket could be built and tested within 10 years.
Von Braun was one of the first people in the media to understand how to package himself in such a way that his message could be carried by his personality. He's a forerunner of the modern media celebrity. He knew how to do it.
Von Braun had long been amongst those lobbying Washington for permission to take the first real step into space, the launching of a satellite. His army team had already developed a missile, the Jupiter, capable of the task. He now used his new status as television's favorite spaceman to push the Army's case.
The next major step in the conquest of space is a satellite rocket, at first unmanned. Just like during the early stage of aviation, military funds will be necessary to start the show on the road.
But President Eisenhower believed the Army should be kept out of space. The launching of a satellite should be seen as a peaceful scientific project. A private company was asked to build a new rocket to a Navy design, the Vanguard. Von Braun's army team had to watch from the sidelines. It's Jupiter rocket in storage.
We were disappointed that we were not the ones to do it. And I think particularly also von Braun was disappointed that he could not sell his idea.
But von Braun's sales pitch was given an unexpected push.
This is Russia on October 4th, 1957. On the launching pad is Sputnik Zemlya 1st. The Soviet Union is launching the first Earth satellite.
The Russians had got there first. The space race had begun.
Until 2 days ago, that sound had never been heard on this Earth. Suddenly, it has become as much a part of 20th century life as the whir of your vacuum cleaner.
Did you admire the Russians for doing it or not?
No, definitely not. I said we should have been the first ones to have it.
We fear this. We fear that they have something out that majority of the people don't know about.
Somebody's fallen down on a job, badly.
Eisenhower had underestimated the depth of public feeling. Americans wanted to be first. National humiliation was complete when the Vanguard rocket, carrying America's satellite, blew up on the launch pad, as von Braun had boldly predicted it would.
When the Vanguard blew up in the launch stand and it was egg all over our face as a country, it was very simple for the Army then to take the tarpaulin off of one of these Jupiter Cs and fire it up.
Vanguard's failure was von Braun's opportunity.
Good morning, gentlemen. Be seated, please. I have a very important announcement for you. We've been assigned the mission of launching a scientific Earth satellite. I promised the Secretary of the Army that we would be ready in 90 days or less. Let's go, Werner.
Notify the blockhouse. Peaceful international cooperation was forgotten. Von Braun and his army team were called on to rescue the reputation of American technology.
Three, two, one. Ignition, space race.
In January 1958, the first American satellite, Explorer, was launched on top of one of von Braun's rockets. In Washington, a delighted von Braun celebrated with the press.
The question is, has any form of life been placed in the satellite?
Maybe we have a Florida cockroach inside, we don't know.
What is the speed of the satellite?
What do you get?
5.4 miles per second, which is 19,400 miles per hour.
Von Braun approached his 47th birthday, he'd reached a level of international recognition rarely won by a scientist. The town of Huntsville turned out to celebrate. Confident of explorer's success, von Braun had already outlined a timetable for a national space program. He proposed a mission to take man to the moon within 5 years, but President Eisenhower was unimpressed.
Eisenhower did not favor a human spaceflight program. He was much more in favor of satellites and scientific probes and focusing on the scientific accomplishments of space. Von Braun and all of his followers had a much more romantic view of space exploration.
He felt that it helped create excitement when you had humans on board. The public became more involved.
Von Braun's vision of space exploration was one a president found difficult to ignore. He was now America's space prophet. Schoolboys wrote to him asking how they could become involved.
More and more teenagers are passing up rock and roll for a rocket roll. Sister Dung Scotus, a physics teacher, supervises members of the Austin Rocket Society attempting to send a mouse along.
The priorities were being driven by the entertainment value of what von Braun was proposing. And quite clearly, his vision of space exploration was more interesting than the one that Eisenhower was proposing.
There was a new frontier to be crossed. Von Braun successfully appealed to the American pioneering spirit that wanted to cross it. In spite of Eisenhower's skepticism, the first seven astronauts began training for von Braun's space adventure.
You could see he was still a young man in his mind about, tell me more, I want to go do that. I hope, prior to any manned flight, that you'll find enough room in here to take a friend with you next time. Guess who he was talking about?
Von Braun's commitment to his dream hadn't changed since childhood.
As far as outer space is concerned, you can, of course, keep dreaming forever because the place is unlimited.
He always was kind of a little shy because I think he realized that a lot of what he was saying was still the child in him, the boy, the little boy, basically wanting to do it for the sake of adventure. But when you have to talk to politicians, real hard-nosed ones, and ones who are worrying about their re-election, you can't let on.
The message to Congress was a lot tougher. Von Braun knew how to get money from the hard-nosed politicians. He played the Russian card.
I'm convinced that the Russian concept is very clear. They consider the control of space around the Earth very much like, shall we say, the great maritime powers considered the control of the seas in the 16th to the 18th century. And they say, if we want to control this planet, we have to control the space around it.
He often told the story that if we don't hurry up, when we land on the moon, we'll probably be greeted there by Soviet customs.
Suppose this here's the Earth, this is the target, the space station will still be overhead, and the missile will be here. We can shoot at it, even if you don't know the exact location, and even if it's a moving target.
He used the idea of orbiting nuclear platforms that could drop bombs on the United States to try and convince American politicians that they should approve the billions of dollars necessary to take the first step, whether that was a space station or a trip to the moon.
Mr. President, I would not rule out the chance to preserve a nucleus of human specimens.
It's von Braun, the Cold War warrior, that some see caricatured in the film Dr. Strangelove.
I would think that possibly 100 years.
You mean people could actually stay down there for 100 years?
It would not be difficult, mein Führer. Nuclear reactors could... I'm sorry, Mr. President.
Von Braun wasn't blind to the questions raised by military involvement in space, but he'd made his choice at the age of 20. Now his nuclear-tipped rockets could destroy this world before man had explored another.
Auf Besuch nach Deutschland kam Werner von Braun.
For von Braun, that was a risk worth taking.
Sollen wir heute
unsere Arbeiten zur Erschließung des Weltraums einstellen, weil Raketen wie Flugzeuge auch militärisch eingesetzt werden können? Wo enden alle diese Fragen? Sollen wir abwarten, bis auf dem Mond die rote Fahne hochgeht?
Von Braun said, a person who is developing a new technology. It's very tragic, but they always have to look in two directions, like the old god Janus, who had two faces. The one is in the direction of a new development, a new activity for mankind, a new opening, almost a new state of existence and of life. The other phase is toward the use of these instruments for military purposes.
Gather round while I sing you of Werner von Braun, a man whose allegiance is ruled by expedience.
Von Braun believed the use a rocket was put to was not the moral responsibility of the man who built it. Not everyone shared this conviction.
Don't say that he's hypocritical. Say rather that he's apolitical. Once the rockets are up, who cares where they come down? That's not my department, says Werner von Braun.
In 1959, it was decided von Braun's rockets would only be heading into space. The team became part of the country's new National Space Agency, NASA. It was the opportunity von Braun had always hoped for, but he found himself racing once again to catch up.
Half an hour ago, the Russians announced that they'd put the first man into space.
A cosmonaut, Yuri Gagarin, spent 2 hours orbiting the Earth. The celebrations in Moscow were broadcast to the world.
Here is a man who has done and seen things that no other living person has done or seen.
It was another blow to American prestige, one felt acutely by her new president, John F. Kennedy. The following month, von Braun's Redstone rocket lifted America's first astronaut into space, but only for a few minutes. Kennedy asked Vice President Johnson to come up with a proposal that would put America first again. It was to the country's space prophet that Johnson turned.
Werner von Braun prepared a 10-page response, and the word I like best from that extract is that we have a sporting chance to beat the Russians to a landing on the moon.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
And I think it was the von Braun letter gave rise to his May 1961 decision to announce to the Congress that we would go to the moon by the end of the decade.
Only one team in America was capable of building a large enough rocket to put a man on the moon, von Braun's. In September 1962, Kennedy visited Huntsville to hear how the team would do it. 20 years after selling his rocket to Hitler, von Braun was again doing what he did best. The team was working on plans for a giant three-stage rocket to be called the Saturn V. It would stand more than 350 feet high and would be one of America's greatest engineering undertakings.
The idea was to launch something like 120 tons into Earth's orbit with the concentrated energy of a small nuclear bomb in its fuel tanks and then put people on it.
Von Braun's team would be responsible only for the rocket. Saturn would take the astronauts beyond Earth's orbit, and then its mission would be complete. The astronauts would go on to the moon in the command module. Von Braun knew how to impress a president. He took him down to the test stand for the firing of Saturn engines.
The noise is just on you, just like that. And the next thing you feel is the heat on your face. And it also, the heat will come up your pants leg, and it's scary the first time that you experience one of these. But Kennedy, you could tell he was really into this, and von Braun was telling him what was happening, and then all of a sudden it just stopped, and as you know, it's over just like that. And Kennedy turned, he had that big Kennedy smile, and he grabbed von Braun's hand and shook it and said, "Wonderful, wonderful, Dr. von Braun. I am tremendously impressed with that machine."
Kennedy left Huntsville sure the moon was within his country's grasp. Over the next 10 years, von Braun's rockets would carry American astronauts deeper and deeper into space. The moon was the immediate priority, but von Braun's ambition was greater than that. He'd already begun to think about the next step.
My personal guess will be that for a number of years we'll continue to explore the planets with unmanned equipment, and men will then probably follow, but that, I believe, is anywhere between 1 and 2 decades away, a manned flight to Mars.
On the morning of July the 16th, 1969, 1 million people were parked along the Florida coast. All eyes were on the Apollo 11 moon rocket. For von Braun, it was the culmination of everything he'd worked for.
I think we arrived at 5 o'clock in the morning. The temperature was about 30 degrees, and we were already sweating and exhausted. And Werner showed up, and he was glowing. You know, he was relaxed, he was smiling, and this was his day. And that's what he said, "This is my day."
We're aiming for our planned liftoff at 32 minutes past the hour.
The real reason for this trip may simply be ambition, the ambition of one man, this man. He alone can be called the father of the moon rocket, the leader of a team of men who all regard him as the main inspiration of Apollo.
2, 1, 0, all engines running.
Von Braun watched what he called his huge bird lift off towards the moon. He'd earlier told the press that the world had embarked on a new step in man's evolution. The rocket his team had built would help secure man's future.
"Can you see the water flapping around on the top of this foam kit?"
"That's affirmative, 11.
"That really is water, though, I'll tell you."
It was for Werner a science fiction dream coming true. Apollo 11 was really the crowning point of his career and of our work.
"We got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes on the lunar."
But at the moment of von Braun's greatest triumph, the past came back to haunt him. His public profile attracted the attention of those who felt they'd played their part in building the moon rocket.
He was shown as a hero to the American population, and more important, dangerous, to the children, school children. They probably say, "Look, you young American children, try to become like that man." It was a shock, because I said, "My God, von Braun, but I know this guy."
The details of von Braun's past were buried 25 years before. But now the protests of the slave laborers who'd built the V-2 began to reach public attention. Von Braun was asked to give evidence to German prosecutors investigating the crimes committed at the Mittelwerk. Afterwards, he had to face the press.
"Why do you say that there were very few people who knew about it? The people weren't informed, or what?"
"Well, I mean, what do you know about things that go on behind barbed wires?"
"Do you ever feel the past creeping up on you?"
"Well, I think everybody has to live with this past. But I don't have a bad conscience in this case at all."
"What's in the future for the American space effort?"
"Well, I think I shouldn't drag the American space program into this at all. I'm very proud of this, and this whole thing that I was dealing with today is really..."
The association with the Mittelwerk never quite left him. Von Braun was never charged with war crimes, but the former prisoners would always hold him morally responsible for what they'd suffered. But with the success of the moon landing, NASA seemed to offer him a new beginning, a move to headquarters. He was asked to do what he did so well anyway, sell the next step into space. It meant leaving his team and the city he'd helped to found. Huntsville turned out to say goodbye.
He was Mr. Space in Huntsville. Von Braun came with his rocket pioneers, and Huntsville changed overnight, and they never forgot that. And everyone had the feeling this is the end of an era.
"My friends, there was dancing here in the streets of Huntsville when our first satellite orbited the Earth. And there was dancing again
when the first Americans landed on the moon. I'd like to ask you, don't hang up your dancing slippers.
But by the time von Braun arrived in Washington, it was too late. The country had won the race to the moon. Now its politicians wanted to spend taxpayers' money closer to home. Not even Wernher von Braun could sell a journey to Mars.
The decision had already been made in the White House and the Congress that we were going to go back to a modest space program. And so in many ways, he was a sorry figure here in Washington, D.C., lobbying for a program which every politician in town knew was really dead.
After a bruising 2 years at NASA headquarters, von Braun handed in his resignation. It was the end of his dream. The great space adventure was winding down. It was a difficult time for von Braun. The accusations about his past wouldn't go away, and soon after leaving NASA, he was diagnosed as suffering from cancer.
Aber er hat gute Arbeit geleistet, aber die Tatsache, dass er Parteimitglied war, wurde ihm später dann in Amerika vorgehalten. Er hat mir das persönlich erzählt, auch sehr bekümmert. Er hatte den Eindruck, nun, wo man alles Wissen aus ihm herausgenommen hatte, könnte er eigentlich abtreten. Und man schob ihn ab. Und ich führe seine spätere Krebskrankheit auch auf dieses totale Enttäuschtsein zurück.
Von Braun's last years were a painful battle against the disease. As he fought it, his thoughts returned to the decision he'd taken 40 years before. The pact struck with the military in pursuit of his dream. In hospital, he asked of friends, did we do the right thing? Was it worth the cost?
He kept asking that question, but I believe the answer was always the same. The innate drive to develop spaceflight for mankind, and that was such a strong drive in him, such a strong power, that he just had to arrive at that answer again and again.
For many, the answer was less clear-cut. Von Braun died in 1977. Before his death, he'd arranged for the last Saturn V rocket to make its way to the Space Museum he'd helped to found in Huntsville. It lies on its side amongst his other rockets, a monument to his personal crusade. In the years following his death, his vision of the future was clouded by revelations about his past. It became clear that the bright hope of man's exploration of space had been bought at a dark price. But Wernher von Braun's legacy remains, his belief in a future for man in space.
We know that man's spirit must now, as always, accept the challenge of the unknown. Man will pull on his seven-league boots and take giant strides across space to the nearer planets of our solar system. The rockets we look at now are still tiny compared to those that will follow. And man has just begun to scratch the surface of knowledge about his Earth and the universe. It is the most exciting and demanding challenge man has yet faced.
And from 3:05 tomorrow afternoon, you can chat online to Buzz Aldrin, the astronaut who accompanied Neil Armstrong on the first trip to the moon. Log on to www.bbc.co.uk/talkingpoint.